Welcome to Catholic Answers Live, the program where you participate with your questions about apologetics and evangelization, including the most important theological, spiritual, moral, and social issues facing the world today. Call now with your question for today's guest, toll free, 1-888-31-TRUTH. That's 888-318-7884. Now, from San Diego, Catholic Answers Live.
Oh, we did it again. We've got another great big Friday show for you here on Catholic Answers Live. Second hour, Gloria Purvis is going to be here. You know Gloria? Gloria does the Morning Glory show with Brian Patrick on EWTN. Just a fantastic person, a wonderful host of that show. And she's going to come and talk with us about being Black and Catholic in America. Have you ever thought about that? I think there's a lot of folks think if you're Black, that almost guarantees that you're Protestant. And maybe a lot of people are surprised to find out quite how many Black people are Catholic here in the United States. And we'll talk to her about what that experience is. Does that make her a member of overlapping communities, or does that make her an outsider in every community that she's in? Gloria is well qualified to talk to all that and share that with us. And we didn't do that because the Black Panther is opening this weekend. That's an extra bonus. 888-318-7884 is our number. This hour, the Me Too movement. It is the movement of the moment. Really horrific stories have come out about rich and powerful and famous men abusing or their position and mistreating women in the workplace. How do we respond to that as Catholics? How do we respond to what we're hearing? The obvious prevalence of the abuse and the obvious need for there to be justice, but also healing. Many calls for change. Does that apply to us as well? We're discussing the Me Too movement this hour here on Catholic Answers Live. If you have questions or would like to share your take, 888-318-7884. Our guest could not be more qualified to talk about this, Don Eden Goldstein. Don received a doctorate in sacred theology, summa cum laude, I might add, from the University of St. Mary of the Lake. The first woman to receive, in the history of the university, to receive a canonical doctorate. She also is an award-winning author under the pen name Don Eden, and now assistant professor of dogmatic theology at Holy Apostles College and Seminary in Cromwell, Connecticut. Her books include Remembering God's Mercy, also The Thrill of the Chaste, My Peace I Give You, Healing Sexual Wounds with the Help of the Saints, two of which I am holding up now for those of you who are watching. Don Eden Goldstein, thanks so much for being with us.
Thanks so much for having me, Si. I really appreciate it.
And when I talk about your various accomplishments and whatnot, one thing maybe our listeners, some will know because they know you and some will not, you are a convert to the Catholic faith. Your story begins, you were born into a Jewish family in New York City. So want to tell you, just let us know a little bit about how you ended up here, a Catholic theologian, talking about the Me Too movement with me.
Sure. Well, my family was light observance, but I did receive a Reformed Jewish upbringing, and I was a bat mitzvah, so I was an adult in the eyes of the Jewish faith. As a child, I had certain wounds. My parents divorced. That was a big big wound. After they were separated, I was sexually abused for the first time. Now, I realize myself suffering from PTSD that there are people who are triggered. So throughout this show, I want to be very careful to use only the most general terms, the most general language when speaking about abuse out of sensitivity for listeners. But it is important to be truthful and honest with oneself and to bring things such as the problems of abuse into the light, which is why I am open about this. My first abuse occurred, it was committed by an acquaintance, actually a janitor at the temple that my family attended. Later on, after my parents' divorce, I was abused at home, particularly by a boyfriend of my mother. And so as a teenager, I had wounds. I suffered from depression, which was cyclical. Suicidal depression, which was only later diagnosed accurately as PTSD and not simply major depression as it was originally diagnosed. And I felt, when I was a college student, I felt that I wanted love, but I didn't believe that I was valuable for who I was. I thought, because of my wounds, that I was valuable only for what I did. And so I tried to find love through things that were not love. I didn't believe that any man would possibly want to marry me unless he knew me sexually. And so since I was acting out of my wounds, this ultimately only compounded my unhappiness. In one of the books you mentioned, The Thrill of the Chaste, I talk about how, as a Catholic, I experienced healing from that particular wound that had caused me to act out in my younger years. But I did find something that I really enjoyed in life that was a productive thing for me, which was writing. So in my 20s, I became a writer, specifically a rock journalist, a rock and roll historian, and I'm still very proud of that time of my life. Since I loved music of the 1960s, I tracked down artists from that era, like Del Shannon, Gene Pitney, Brian Wilson, and interviewed them and wrote about them for record labels that would hire me to write the booklets, liner notes for reissues of artists' music. But there was still a God-shaped vacuum in my life that was ultimately fulfilled through discovering the truth of God in Christ. And that came about, as I've talked about on Catholic Answers before, through Chesterton. I was interviewing a rock musician. His name is Ben Eschbach, and he was at the time in a power pop band from Los Angeles called the Sugar Plastic. You can look them up. As a friend of mine says, they're just a Google and a gaggle away. And I was asking Ben Eschbach what he was reading lately, and he mentioned this book that I'd never heard of by this author I'd never heard of, The Man Who Was Thursday by G.K. Chesterton. And I read this book just expecting to have something I could talk about with the musician when I saw him again. And to my surprise, I found this very profound theology of Christian suffering that Chesterton lays out in The Man Who Was Thursday. That led me first to become a Protestant, because I had this image of Catholicism as being about rules, so I decided I didn't like rules. I was going to be ABC, anything but Catholic. Uh-huh. Wanted to do my own thing, have my own identity. Ultimately, as I've said in interviews that people can find on the Catholic Answers website, if they look up Dawn Eden on Catholic.com, I go into much more detail about my conversion in those earlier interviews. But ultimately, I found that it was in the church that Jesus founded, where I could have my true identity as the woman, the daughter of God in Christ, whom God created me to be. But once I became Catholic, I still was this person who had suffered the trauma of my parents' divorce, who had suffered the trauma of sexual abuse, who had suffered the trauma of my own sins, because while I was not responsible for my abuse, nobody's responsible for their abuse, I was responsible for actions that I did as an adult that were sinful. So I needed to find healing, and I knew that there was no other place than the Catholic faith where I could find healing. Not to say that psychology doesn't have its place, but spiritual wounds need spiritual healing. And in the books that you mentioned earlier, My Peace I Give You, Healing Sexual Wounds with the Help of the Saints, and Remembering God's Mercy, I write about how I found that place of healing in and through my Catholic faith, the life of the sacraments and scripture, and through learning about saints who had wounds like mine, who found healing in Christ.
Dawn, it's such a beautiful story, as all conversion stories are, because they end up with the person being the friend of Christ, which is as good as it can get for us. But I wonder, having lived through all that, having spent so much of your life helping others to find that healing, then this thing happens, this Me Too movement, where these things are coming out that I don't feel like I'm an overly innocent person, but I have to say I was shocked by that some of these people who seem to be entirely respectable people behaved in this way towards women. So what is your response when you start to hear these stories coming out?
Well, first of all, it's very important that the whole problem of sexual abuse come out into the light. And although you are correct in saying that the Me Too movement is being spearheaded by women who want to raise consciousness about abuse perpetrated against women, very often by men who are, the perpetrators very often being men who are in positions of power. At the same time, it's important that abuse perpetrated against men come into the light as well, that women are not the only victims. And I know you didn't mean that, but I just wanted to be extremely clear about that for our listeners. And at the same time, while it's important that this problem be brought into the light and that we bring perpetrators to justice and that the victims learn that they're not alone and that we put safeguards in place to prevent further victimization, the Me Too movement, and this is not in any way to disparage it, but it's just an honest way of speaking, it only takes us so far. Oh. Just as in if somebody has experienced a tragedy, like a wartime tragedy where they're physically injured, it's no slander against the doctor who fixes a person's injured arm to say that the physical healing only takes us so far. So with the Me Too movement, it's like a forensic approach, a more kind of material, secular approach to saying that to stop abuse, we need to do these take these legal actions, take these governmental actions, we need to take these social actions, which are important. But it's no slander against the movement to say that leaves the whole problem of how do we heal. And that's the area that I've been researching for the past 6 years since the publication of my first book on healing, my piece I give you. I've been focusing on finding healing through Jesus Christ, the divine physician.
Dawn Eden Goldstein is our guest. We're talking the Me Too movement, or I don't know if you're supposed to say hashtag Me Too movement, but this striking moment in our society's ongoing history where we're realizing a lot of things are not as maybe many thought they were. But we, in particular, Dawn, it's fascinating to hear you say that about it can only take us so far. So we'll talk about how to go that farther step when we come back. If you have questions or comments about the Me Too movement, would like to discuss it with Dawn, give us a call, 888-318-7884. If you spell that out, it's 888-31-TRUTH. We'll be right back with more after this on Catholic Answers Live.
We're here for you. Call now. Catholic Answers Live.
Hello, my friends. This is Christopher Check, president of Catholic Answers, and I'm challenging you to take the 20 Answers Challenge. Here's how the challenge works. When you purchase the sampler of all 26 books in the 20 Answers series, we are going to knock 60% off the price, and we're challenging you to finish them all this Lent and Easter season. And this year, to make it easier, we're offering free shipping on the sampler if you live in the continental United States. That's 60% off, free shipping, and over 500 answers to questions you have about the Catholic faith. Join us this Lent and Easter to take the 20 Answers Challenge and become better at defending your faith. Call 1-888-291-8000 or visit the shop at Catholic.com now to get your set and begin taking the 20 Answers Challenge today.
We struggle with sin. We're distracted in prayer. We find it hard to be loving and easy to be selfish. Thankfully, the church has given us Lent, the perfect time for reform, of reconversion to God and His will for us. The saints of the Counter-Reformation faced greater obstacles than these, yet they each found the grace to persevere during a tumultuous time in the church. How can we do the same? Reform yourself is a good place to start. We all need to reform our souls. This Lent, let the saints who reformed the church show you how. Order your copy of Reform Yourself today by calling 1-888-291-8000, visiting the shop at catholic.com, or asking for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
You've heard that St. Paul Street Evangelization supports hundreds of teams of evangelists sharing the good news. But did you know that some of these teams are public prayer stations? Set up a sign on the sidewalk and offer prayer and encouragement to those you encounter. Everyone needs prayer. Try this new method of witnessing to Jesus. Contact St. Paul Street Evangelization to get started at streetevangelization.com. That's streetevangelization.com.
Call now with your question, 888-318-7884. This is Catholic Answers Live.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. I am Cy Kellett, your host. Our guest this hour, Don Eden Goldstein, is the author of quite a few books, actually. We're talking particularly, I suppose maybe the most appropriate one to mention again and again today is my piece I give you, Healing Sexual Wounds with the Help of the Saints. That's from a few years ago. That's available from, is it Ave Maria Press?
Yes, that's right.
But the best place to get it is at shop.catholic.com. I don't know if you know that, Don, but that's the best yes, place to
yes,
get it.
Yes, I'm very thankful that shop.catholic.com has it.
Yeah. Again, our number, 888-318-7884. We're talking about the Me Too movement, 888-318-7884. And, you know, I suppose the root level thing that probably everybody knows about Jesus is forgiveness, all right? Like, you're supposed to forgive. When we're talking about things like sexual abuse, for example, the things that are being reported in the Me Too movement, what role does forgiveness play? Or are we asking too much of someone to say, you move towards forgiveness, you need to move that direction?
Thank you for asking that, Cy, because it's such an important question. The first thing that we should all be aware of, whether in the church or in the in wider society, is that forgiveness should never be used as a substitute for justice. It should never be something that's opposed to justice. Too many times in the Catholic world, before the abuse scandals went public, people who reported abuse were pressured sometimes, not all the time, but many of them reported being pressured. Well, Father so and so says he didn't mean to do such and such, so you have to forgive him.
Ah, yeah.
And that is itself an abuse of what, you know, forgiveness is. It should never be something that's imposed on someone, and it should never be used instead of justice. I think that a good model for us in this respect is Saint Maria Goretti, who, after being sexually attacked, because there's no other way to describe what happened to her. Often people will emphasize, oh, but she stayed a virgin. Yes, physically, Maria Goretti was a virgin, but she was genuinely sexually attacked, mm-hmm. sexually assaulted, and when she was on her deathbed, she was asked by a priest, do you forgive your attacker? And she said, yes, I forgive him, and I want him to be in heaven with me. But she also was asked by the police, what happened? Who did it? And she told the police exactly what happened.
Right,
and there
was
no conflict in that.
Right.
There was no conflict in, you know, forgiving him and wanting to make darn sure that he went to justice and didn't harm anyone, you know, anymore.
Right.
And Maria is a saint because of her forgiving heart, but also because of her service to truth. You know, if Maria had said when she was on her deathbed, oh, you know, nothing really happened, and I don't want that nice person to get into trouble, she wouldn't be a saint.
Yes, that's a beautiful point, Dawn. That, yeah, telling the truth, that's it keeps the forgiveness connected to reality. You don't have to pretend the reality isn't real.
Exactly. That's right. So forgiveness can never be opposed to truth or opposed to justice. Moreover, forgiveness is not the same as reconciliation. And I think that's also something that is difficult for people to understand. Because, like, for example, you know, with I know from my own experience, even though my mother was not my abuser, I know that I had pain in my relationship with my mother that was related to the abuse. Now, I want to say also, praise God, my mother and I have fully reconciled. She's supportive of my apostolate, and I thank God for that. But I can tell you honestly that I remember going to confession and telling the confessor, I'm mad at my mother. And like many abuse victims, I couldn't quite explain what it was, that I'm mad at her because she hasn't acknowledged the pain that the abuse caused, which I believe she was aware of, and I believe she could have prevented, and so on. I couldn't say all that. But what the priest said was, well, you know, you have to forgive your mother, so for your penance, call your mother. And that was a terrible thing for me, because what the priest was saying is that if anyone has harmed you, you have to initiate going to that person and making contact. That's not what forgiveness is. I had to look to the catechism to find out what forgiveness really is. And the catechism specifies that forgiveness is interior, and that it ideally can and it does lead to reconciliation, but that the command to forgive is fulfilled even when we forgive only interiorly. And in the case of the commandment, honor one's father and mother, if our father or our mother is abusive, then we are an occasion of sin for that person. And if forgiveness means being loving, wanting God's best for that person, then for me to forgive, if I'm someone who's been abused by a parent, for me to forgive that parent can mean having no outreach to that parent, so that the parent doesn't have an opportunity to be abusive.
Wow. Yep. Again, 888-318-7884, our number. We're talking with Dawn Eden Goldstein about the hashtag MeToo movement. I want to get to some calls. Shall we go to the phones?
Sure.
All right, let's start with Beth in Duluth, Minnesota, listening on Real Presence Radio. Beth, thank you for your call. You are on with Dawn Eden Goldstein. Your question, please.
Hi, thank you for taking my call. I typically would have turned the station to hear the hashtag MeToo movement being talked about again, but I actually paused and felt moved to call in when you mentioned the impact to men, and I just want to thank you for that, and I really appreciate you taking this opportunity here in a public forum to bring that up. It's so important, and it hasn't been mentioned enough, and certainly is an important piece of sexual abuse, so thank you for that.
Thank you very much, Beth. I appreciate that. Yes, I do think that it's very important to mention, and in my experience since writing my piece I Give You, I've found that the statistics with regard to the percentage of men who have suffered at least childhood sexual abuse, I don't know about the percentage with adult sexual abuse, but I have found that the statistics of men who have suffered abuse in childhood are grossly underestimated, and I think it's simply because they're not reported, that there's a real stigma attached to reporting that for men, because in meeting victims, meeting readers of my book, I think actually that there may in fact be more male victims of childhood sexual abuse in terms of percentage-wise than female, and my thought about that, this is completely anecdotal and I could be wrong, is that for the abusers who abuse young girls, it's a kind of a crime of opportunity where there might be this young girl who's living with her mom and the mom's boyfriend, mm-hmm. and the boyfriend in this close proximity with the girl takes advantage of that and abuses. Whereas when I speak to men who suffered childhood abuse, it's someone who is a predator who sought out that little boy and sought out other boys, so that the predators who prey upon boys have more victims.
Again, Dawn Eden Goldstein is our guest. We're talking about the Me Too movement, and we're talking in addition about how we move to the state of healing, which is the most important thing. We'll be right back with more of that after this on Catholic Answers Live.
Catholic Answers Live.
Look to EWTN for inspiring Lenten programming.
Jesus calls all of us to leave something behind. And Lent is a providential time to acknowledge what that is and then to do it. Now look, we've all got something to leave behind. Jesus knows it. We know it. We're better off without it. And we can't unreservedly follow him until we leave that behind.
Lenten programs now through Holy Thursday on EWTN Radio and TV.
Just like the saints of the Counter-Reformation, our own souls are in constant need of reform, of reconversion to God and His will for us. We struggle with sin. We become distracted in prayer. We find it hard to be loving and easy to be selfish. In Reform Yourself, Sean McAfee shows you how these magnificent saints can be guides to your own personal transformation. We all need to reform our souls. Let the saints who reformed the church show you how. Order your copy of Reform Yourself today by calling 1-888-291-8000, visiting the shop at Catholic.com, or asking for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
Did the Catholic Church add books to the Bible? Or did Protestants remove 7 books from the Old Testament? Why Catholic Bibles Are Bigger takes you on a fact-filled tour through the history of the Bible, revealing the whole story behind the lost books of the Protestant Old Testament. With the latest information and discourse on crucial issues, Why Catholic Bibles Are Bigger is a book that belongs in the library of every serious student of Scripture. And as a special bonus, if you order online, we'll add an ebook copy of 15 Myths, Mistakes, and Misrepresentations About the Deuterocanon to your order absolutely free. Get your free ebook today. Order your copy of Why Catholic Bibles Are Bigger by logging on to our online shop at shop.catholic.com.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. Super big Friday show. I don't want to neglect to remind you that for this month, all of the 20 Answers books, all 26 of the 20 Answers books, when you buy them together, are on sale for 60% off. That's, you just pay 40% of their usual cost and you get them. And you know what else? They get shipped to you for free. You just go to shop.catholic.com and get your entire complete set of all 26 20 Answers books from Catholic Answers on all kinds of different subjects. 60% off, no shipping. Go to shop.catholic.com. We are back and talking a bit about the Me Too movement. If you're not familiar with that, the Me Too movement has to do with this kind of moment in which people are taking the opportunity to talk about many things that have remained hidden for a long time in relation to sex abuse. I spoke at the beginning about how women were speaking out about how men had abused them. And you made the very important point, don't forget about men. And Beth just made that point, and you don't have to worry about me. I don't feel scolded. that's a very important part of this. But I want to ask you a little bit about, you began by saying that as important as the Me Too movement is, and without any disparaging of it, because it's very important for people to get justice. It's very important for people to get to say, yes, this happened to me. You said I'm forgetting exactly how you said it, but it's not adequate. It's not the full response. There has to be more response.
If you're traumatized, there's more than the physical trauma. There's the emotional trauma, but, and also And also, we keenly feel the spiritual trauma, and especially as Catholics, you know, regardless of whether our abuse was committed by someone acting, by someone acting as a member of the church or not, the spiritual component is something that we feel deeply when we've suffered abuse.
Can you talk a little bit about your own healing related to that, related to your spiritual healing? How did you come to a place of spiritual healing?
Well, thank you for asking about that, Sai, because that really is my strongest area of expertise. In that, I'm not a psychologist, I'm not a sociologist. I just speak as a survivor of the abuse. Of abuse, but also as someone who's studied theology and now has a doctorate in sacred theology. So when I first entered the Catholic Church in Holy Week 2006, I knew that as far as spiritual healing went, there was nowhere else to go. Mm-hmm. I had to find that healing in the church. And so I started to read the works of Archbishop Fulton J. Sheen, a book called Peace of Soul, another book called Calvary and the Mass. And I started to learn this theology of suffering, redemptive suffering, that Archbishop Sheen talks about. And then I started also to study Ignatian spirituality, which became the topic of my other book on healing, Remembering God's Mercy. And through those, I developed personally a kind of spirituality of wounds. I have these wounds emotionally, spiritually, from abuse. And when I pray at Mass, I'm looking at the crucifix, and I'm thinking about Jesus, who I'm going to receive. And I think about how Jesus was and forever, you know, will always be someone who has wounds. We know from St. John's Gospel that Jesus, in his glorified body, chose to retain his wounds, and that they are now no longer sources of pain, but they are rather powerful reminders of his grace, that he voluntarily chose to suffer for my sins, for all the sins of the world, so that this same heart which was pierced might radiate grace. As a Catholic, I know that through my baptism, I have been incorporated into Christ and united with his suffering, his death, and resurrection. Now, there are times, thankfully not all the time, I do have joy and happiness, but there are times when I'm really just feeling the passion. I'm feeling the union with Jesus in his suffering and dying, and not feeling the union with his resurrection. But what I've learned is that Jesus, when he comes to me in the Eucharist, even though he's coming to me as he is now, the risen Jesus would not be who he is if it wasn't for his wounds, for his historical life. Jesus' history is not erased with the resurrection. Not even his memories are erased with the resurrection. Jesus remembers every bit of spit that he felt directed at him. He remembers every blow. He remembers having his clothes ripped off of him. I don't want to get too graphic, but you know, we've seen the Passion of the Christ, or we've just looked at a crucifix, and we know from the Stations of the Cross, Jesus was stripped of his clothes. If that isn't sexual abuse, I don't know. I don't know what is. Certainly, he can identify profoundly with those who've suffered any kind of abuse. And yet, he can now remember all of that. Now, he doesn't remember them as though they were good things. He knows that they were evil things. But what he remembers when he remembers his passion. This is something that I say, I think Remembering God's Mercy. He remembers the passionate love with which he chose to suffer this so that he might heal us. And so if I can enter into Jesus' memories, then I can see that even though the abuse that was done to me was evil, Jesus was not separated from me at the time that I suffered this abuse. Jesus was with me in a profound way, that I was in a mystical way suffering with him, and because I walked this Via Crucis, this way of the cross, with him, I now know that my own way of the cross has its end in the resurrection, and that the invisible grace of the risen Christ is with me even when I don't feel it. You know, part of the definition of grace is that we don't feel it, but we can over time feel or begin to feel its effects in us. And one of the effects of that grace is simply having the knowledge that I am not alone.
You know, when I hear you speak of it, however, I have to say I end up with a question related to your, you know, feeling angry at your mom. And that is, wasn't there ever anger at God that you had to overcome? Was there ever anger at him that you had to move beyond?
That's a profound question that you're asking, Cy, and I'm shy about answering it because I don't want to lie to you or to myself. I don't consciously feel angry at God, but I have noticed many times that I have had things that I struggle with where I think, if only this abuse hadn't happened to me, or if only God hadn't permitted me to sin, certainly God never positively wanted me to sin.
Right.
But even if something isn't positively in his will, it may be something he permits. I mean, that's part of his omnipotence, that he permits my free will even when I sin against him. So sometimes I will catch myself thinking that, you know, if such and such hadn't happened, my life would be so much better. And that's a kind of a hidden resentment against God. And that's something that I seek to work out through staying close to the sacraments, the Eucharist and confession, through scripture reading, through prayer, and through having a good spiritual director to learn to see how God has always loved me, has never stopped loving me, has only, you know, permitted things in as much as that these things, being part of my history, can help me to learn how to return his love in a new and more beautiful way.
We're talking the Me Too movement, and our guest is Don Eden Goldstein, a theologian and survivor and former rock music journalist. you got a big resume. We'll take a quick break and then we'll come back. We've got calls. I want to get to those calls, but it's the right time to take a break. We'll take a break. We'll be right back with more after this on Catholic Answers Live.
This is Dale Alquist of the American Chesterton Society, and you're listening to Catholic Answers Live.
Hi, this is Tim Staples, and I'm challenging you to take the 20 Answers Challenge. Here's how the challenge works. When you purchase the sampler of all 26 books in the 20 Answers series, we're going to knock 60% off the price, and we're challenging you to finish them all this Lent and Easter season. And this year, to make it easier, we're offering free shipping on the sampler if you live in the continental United States. That's 60% off free shipping and over 500 answers to questions you have about the Catholic faith. Join us this Lent and Easter to take the 20 Answers Challenge, and together we can be part of something great. Call 1-888-291-8000 or visit the shop at Catholic.com now to get your set and begin taking the 20 Answers Challenge today.
Whatever I have learned, writes Catholic Answers founder Carl Keating, I have learned from the masters of the craft. In his new book, Booked for Life, a bibliographic memoir of an accidental apologist, Carl gives future generations a roadmap of what it takes and what it means to become a Catholic apologist. In the way only Carl can, he recounts numerous real-life situations he has encountered in his long career that illustrate the apologetic lessons he's learned. Then, drawing on a lifetime of experience, Carl reveals the books that helped him learn to defend the Catholic faith. Order your copy of Booked for Life today by calling 1-888-291-8000, logging on to the shop at Catholic.com, or asking for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
Catholic Answers Live is brought to you in part by CatholicSingles.com, the website for Catholics who want to meet others who share their faith and values for faith, fellowship, and love. You can learn more at CatholicSingles.com. Catholic Answers Live thanks CatholicSingles.com for their generous support.
Call now with your question, 888-318-7884. This is Catholic Answers Live.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. I am Cy Kellett, your host. Our guest, one of the good ones, Don Eden Goldstein, also writes under the name Don Eden. So if you look up Don Eden, you will find her as well. Second hour, I want to just remind you, Gloria Purvis is going to be here from Morning Glory, the show on the EWTN Mornings, and we're going to talk about being Black and Catholic in America. Looking forward to talking with Gloria. But if you can't stand strong opinions and sturdy Catholic teaching, maybe you better find something else to do when Gloria is here. We got lots of calls. Shall we go back to the phones,
sure.
Dawn?
All sure, right. Yes.
Let's go to Gil. Gil, good to hear from you, Gil. You are on with Don Eden Goldstein. What's your question, Gil?
Oh, good evening. I know that in Proverbs 17:17 it says that a friend loveth at all times. How do I help a friend of mine that has PTSD where they take out their problems on you because of frustration or whatever going through that?
That's a very good question. And yes, people with PTSD, if they're not getting help, and sometimes even if they are getting help, may be liable to express their pain and act out in ways that can be difficult for those who are friends with them, love them, to cope with. I think, you know, the first thing that you can do is to pray for your friend. You know, really pray for your friend and love your friend and seek to be patient with your friend, which you very likely are already doing, especially since you quote that Proverbs line, a friend loveth at all times. Second, it would be good to read up yourself on PTSD. If you go to the Veterans Affairs website, the website, I can look up the URL. I think it might be ptsd.va.gov. But they have some good information just on, yes, it is ptsd.va.gov. So the more you know about it, the more you'll be sensitive to things that your friend, you know, might be doing, and it might help your patience to know that it's not you necessarily that your friend is responding to. Your friend is responding to the trauma. But it would also be good for you as a friend to recommend that your friend get psychological and spiritual help. This is something that I'm quite adamant about in my piece, I Give You. There are people whom one will encounter in the Catholic world who will either, if they, I know some priests are like this, that if somebody comes up to them and says, I've suffered abuse, can you help me? Some people will just say, get thee to a therapist, uh-huh, as if a therapist is the only person who could possibly help someone who has suffered trauma. But there are also people in the Catholic world, and we've all met them, who will say, well, you just need to go to adoration, and you just need to pray more rosaries.
Mm-hmm.
Now, as I say in my piece I Give You, the proper response is not an isolated psychological response or isolated spiritual response, because we're not simply brains walking around and we're not simply spirits walking
floating around.
Floating around, exactly. Thank you. Yes, that's right. Don't want to get my metaphors mixed up. We're both. So if you can encourage your friend to seek psychological help and good spiritual help, that would be great. You might want to, if your friend is someone who goes to your parish, you might want to ask your pastor, if I can convince my friend to get help, do you know of a priest in this diocese who ministers in particular to victims of abuse? Because it is better to speak to someone who, if you're getting spiritual help, someone who has experience in that area. Also, if your friend is Catholic, you might want to recommend CatholicTherapists.com, because it is important to have a therapist who, if the therapist doesn't share your faith, at least a therapist who's not going to try to actively, you know, undermine or attack one's faith. So mm-hmm. CatholicTherapists.com is a good resource for people seeking a therapist who shares their faith. At the same time, and I do want to be very strong in emphasizing this, even if you use CatholicTherapists.com, look at the therapist's degrees, look at where the therapist got his or her degrees from. And, you know, if you're concerned, you can even call up the university and say, did such and so and so graduate from this university? You can find out the person's licensing number, because I once went to a therapist who claimed to have a doctorate and was Catholic. Turned out that his diploma was from a degree mill. This person, who was not a helpful therapist, this person actually harmed me. So not abused me, but wasn't someone trustworthy. So even as I recommend Catholic therapists, I just want to say, do your due diligence and just concentrate on getting the best help, whether it's for oneself or for a friend, Gil. I hope that helps.
Does that help you, Gil?
Thank you so much.
Thank you very much.
You're very welcome. God bless you.
Happy to take that call, Gail. Thank you. Let's go to Todd in Dallas, Texas, listening on Guadalupe Radio. Todd, you are on with Don Eden Goldstein. Your question,
Todd.
Please.
Yes, how are you?
Doing well, Todd. Thank you.
I've read your book, and I'd like to comment that I'm disabled, and I listened to the news, and recently I heard that the charitable organization that works in Haiti had a sexual scandal.
Yes, that's
and,
true.
And it also happened in Africa.
Yes.
And there's been a number of reports from the Catholic Church, sex scandals in Australia and Chile. I think that the abuse that's widespread, including Hollywood, and the whole phenomenon is a matter of a primal force trying to be restricted and controlled.
Todd, I'm going to let Don respond to that, because it does. I have to say, I find Todd somewhat convincing in this regard, like that. So much, there's just so much of this that it does. It seems like there's a new story all the time. Is this just the human condition, or is there some other way to approach this?
Well, I have to say that, and I mean, this is something that you and I were discussing or touching on in conversation earlier. When we were discussing the novel of yours that I had read, *Ad Limina*, which is kind of a social commentary but written as science fiction, that we have a larger social problem that expresses itself in many ways, including abuse.
Right.
I think about this with respect to the Florida high school shooting. Now, what I'm about to say is by no means meant to be against gun control. I personally believe that that shooter should never have been permitted to have guns. But if we were to control all the guns, we would still have children like that teenager with broken families. You know, when you look at the histories of these shooters, you find that they come from families of divorce, or the families that never married, and families where there was, you know, a profound lack of love and brokenness, not just abuse. And children are more likely to be abused if they grow up in a household where one parent, particularly the father, is not present. So again, I'm not saying we shouldn't talk about gun control. I'm not saying we shouldn't talk about justice to prosecute those who have committed abuse. We need to do all those things, but we also need to look at how in society we have not supported the natural family, and we have not worked harder on supporting marriage, and married couples also have not necessarily worked hard enough on staying married and on treating marriage as seriously as they need to treat it. And I think that when we're seeing these global seeming outbreaks of abuse, that those are some of the larger issues to consider.
Thank you, Dawn. I'm going to go quickly just because I want to make sure I get as many calls in as I can. So let's go to Anonymous in Wisconsin. Anonymous, you are on. I'm sorry, time is short. So if you could phrase your question relatively quickly for Dawn.
Hi, thanks for taking my call.
Hi.
So the timing is good because you've been getting me to think more about this. But I work as a psychotherapist with predominantly women who've suffered sexual abuse in the military.
Thank you for what you do.
And, you know, I work in a secular setting, but I always try to integrate and ask questions about their faith, if that's a support, you know, a strong system for them, if it's part of a coping skill or part of their recovery. And, you know, I think I have no problem hearing from people that they can reconcile what's happened. They can think about forgiveness and that their relationship to God or Christ is intact. But I had someone say to me recently that the real breakdown was living out their faith in a religious community, reentering the church, being part of religion, worldly religion, when it's predominantly dominated by men in positions of authority. And that's real cognitive dissonance. You know, someone said to me, how do I go back into a setting where I take instruction from a priest or from the Pope or from leaders of the church when, in general, it is men in positions of authority who have betrayed me?
Anonymous, thank you. We have a short time, so I'm going to let Dawn respond.
Thank you. Well, I think one thing that's helpful to remember is what St. John Paul II said in his letter Ordinatio Sacerdotalis, which is on the question of whether women might be ordained priests. He speaks in detail about how the church's non-ordination of women is not something that's intended to be a power play to keep women down, but is rather based on an understanding of the priesthood as being service, and that nobody who wants power should be a priest. So I think it's incumbent upon all of us as a church, priests and lay people, to really understand the priesthood in that way. And I do recommend reading John Paul II's letter for more on that.
Anonymous, thank you very, very much.
Thank
Sorry
you.
We didn't have a little more time to deal with that. Dawn Eden Goldstein has been our guest. You can find her at DawnEden.blogspot.com for the Dawn Patrol. And you're on Twitter quite active. What's your Twitter handle?
Dawn of Mercy.
Dawn of Mercy, or at Dawn of Mercy.
That's right.
At Dawn of Mercy. Dawn Eden Goldstein, the author of My Peace I Give You and Remembering God's Mercy, thank you very much for a very helpful hour.
Thanks so much, Si. God bless you.
We'll be back right after this with Gloria Purvis on being Black and Catholic in America, right after this on Catholic Answers Live.
Welcome to Catholic Answers Live, the program where you participate with your questions about apologetics and evangelization, including the most important theological, spiritual, moral, and social issues facing the world today. Call now with your question for today's guest, toll-free 1-888-31-TRUTH. That's 888-318-7884. Now, from San Diego, Catholic Answers Live.
Welcome back to our great, big, huge, giant Friday show here on Catholic Answers Live. If you weren't uncomfortable with conversations about religion and sex, and we're going to do religion and race this hour. We've decided to make this a big day. We're going to talk about being Black and Catholic in America with one of the hosts of Morning Glory, EWTN's wonderful morning radio show. Gloria Purvis is here with us. Also, Gloria is part of Authentically Free at Last, a DVD set from EWTN. You may have seen her there or on one of her many speaking engagements. Gloria Purvis, thanks so much for being with us.
Hey, Cy. Thanks for having me. Glad to be on.
And for those who might have some wariness about discussing race and religion, does this strike you as a taboo topic, or is this?
No, not for me. But I know some people can feel very uncomfortable talking about it. But I'm not. I'm very open in terms of talking about it. So we can do that.
Well, if we should start with how you became Catholic, because there are large communities of Black Catholics in the United States, some very, very old. Mm-hmm. But you are not from those communities.
No, I'm not. I am from Charleston, South Carolina, which already at the time when I was coming up had a relatively small Catholic population in comparison to the rest of the population. And of that, an even smaller percentage was a Black Catholic population. So it all started because my parents have a value education, and they wanted their children to get the best education available in Charleston. And it just so happened that would be with the Catholics. So I attended Catholic school from first to 12th grade, just like all my sisters. And when I was 12 years old, I had a mystical experience during adoration. It turned out during lunch, our class had a food fight. And being the good kids that we were, we cleaned it up spick and span. And after lunch, we had a religion class with the principal of the school, who was a religious sister, Sister Carmelita. And so she made us sort of do what I would call a public confession. She went one by one and said, "Did you participate in the food fight?" And we had to stand up and answer. And was like, "Yes, sister, I participated in the food fight." And so she'd be like, "Sit down." And she'd go one by one through each student. And so after the whole class confessed this, she was like, "Children, we are going over to the cathedral church." And we went to the lower part of the cathedral church where they had adoration. We had to sit in silence while sister was on her knees trying to work it out with Jesus. I mean, we had her so upset about this food fight. I mean, I can still see her right now with her habit moving around as she was like praying to the Lord. But it was at that time, while sister was praying and working it out with Jesus in the monstrance, I was sitting there silently, and my body was consumed as if it were on fire, but it didn't burn. And I had that instant knowledge that that was real, it was alive. And a few days later, sister came back to our class and said, "Hey, Catholics, I need to pull you aside and get you ready for confirmation." And I went up to her and said, "Sister, I think I'm supposed to be a Catholic."
Wow. Yeah. And now, how did your parents greet that news?
Well, okay, so sister was like, "You know what? You need to ask your parents. You know, you go home and ask your parents. I'm not just going to bring you into the church. You go home and ask your parents." And I was an interesting 12-year-old because I went home and told my parents that I'm going to become Catholic. And I remember my mother saying to me, "Oh, you're going to be a Catholic? Okay. Well, you're going to go to Mass every Sunday, every holy day of obligation. You're not going to eat meat on Fridays, and you're going to pray the rosary." And she was like, "You understand?" I was like, "Yeah." So she was like, "Bet." And I was like, "Bet." And that's how it was. So, yeah, I went to Mass by myself. They dropped me off at the Catholic church, yeah.
Do you think she thought you might be dissuaded by all of that you were going to be doing?
No, I don't think so. I think she wanted me to know that she knew the deal. You know, what my responsibilities, you know, the basic responsibilities for me as a Catholic would be. So I think she wanted me to be clear that she was clear in you know, and, you know, it would be no half-stepping on your responsibilities. You know, you're going to go to church on Sunday, and you're going to go to church on those days that none of us go to church, because that's what you do as a Catholic. And mm-hmm. And I have to say, I think I had a very interesting experience, because since I had no other Catholics in my family to show me the faith, I learned most of the devotions from my Baptist grandmother. So she was the one that when we were driving by a Catholic church in the car, she said, Gloria, you're supposed to make the sign of the cross when you drive past a Catholic church, because that's what you Catholics do. You know,
wow.
She put the rosary around her bedpost and said, Gloria, I'm letting you know that it's okay for you to pray your rosary. I've got a rosary around my bedpost. You pray your rosary. I remember when Saint Mother Teresa came to Charleston, she went to her son, my father, and said, you know, your daughters are Catholic and you need to take them to see this woman. It's important in their faith. And when Pope John Paul II came to Columbia, South Carolina, she went to her son and said, you need to take your daughters to see this Holy Father, because that's important to them and their faith. She was, I mean, just amazing. My parents were amazing. My mother was like, what did you give up for Lent? And she would, you know, whatever our dietary restrictions were, she would, you know, adjust. And the funny thing about this is then all my sisters, some years later, all converted to Catholicism as well. So.
Well, that must be an extraordinary family, though. I can't imagine that that's common for a young Baptist girl to become Catholic, and the family is so. I mean, I don't mean to say that in way against Baptists or anything, but
right.
That's an extraordinary thing that they supported you in that.
Let me just say this. My grandmother was Baptist. My mother was United Methodist Episcopal, so I was a Methodist. But still, yeah, I think. You know, we all believed in God, mm-hmm. and my mother, actually, ironically, when I was baptized as a Methodist, my godmother in the Methodist church was my mother's friend who is Catholic. So my parents had an openness to Catholicism mm-hmm. from their friends, and then it turns out my dad had cousins in the Piedmont region of South Carolina who were Catholic. So, you know, I think they were just happy that I believed and I wanted to practice something other than my own, tastes, you know
right.
what I mean?
Exactly.
So I wasn't giving up God. I was just saying, I'm called over here. And they were like, fine.
Is there any issue when you are Black and Catholic with maybe somehow being considered inauthentically Black? Or is that an issue?
You know, I think it maybe because I'm not a shrinking violet. So I haven't had, you know, there'll be people who make those challenges that'll say things like, you know, the Catholic Church is a racist institution. And how could you be Catholic? Or some people like, how could you even be Christian? You know, they're responsible for all these evils. So, I mean, it's one or the other. It's either, you know, the Catholics are racist or Christianity is not for Black people. I've heard that from a few people and I have a response. You know, I'm not really bothered by that. I remind them that if it weren't for the abolitionist movement's Christian roots, we probably could still be enslaved if it weren't, you know, economically feasible. And I remind them that the civil rights movement had a Christian ethos. And I remind them that the bad behavior of people who adhere to the faith does not mean the tenets of the faith are wrong.
Yeah, amen to that. But okay, so let's ask about the other side then. What about us Catholics who are, I think, frankly, not always used to seeing Black people in our churches. How are you treated as marginally Catholic or maybe suspect in your? I mean, how?
Well,
I've
had a couple experiences. Typically, when I go to a parish that isn't predominantly Black, I'm pretty much ignored. Like I'm invisible.
Mm-hmm.
So that's been an interesting experience. But it is what it is. I don't ascribe any motives behind that. It's just that's what my experience is. When I go to churches that are predominantly Black, you know, people are very welcoming and, you know, they see you and they talk to you and they want to know your name. But I have found in some cases that, and I don't know why this is, some priests, and I'm not going to say all of them because that's definitely not true, but I've noticed some priests only say what's up, you know, the truth about the faith when the bishop shows up. Any other time, it's this idea that they don't have to preach the full gospel, I guess. They're saying things that I'm like, wait a minute, that's not in accord with what we believe. And I wonder and get disappointed why they do that.
Is it because maybe there's an idea that, oh, well, if you're Black American, you are of a certain political stripe and
oh,
that
yeah.
Can, yeah.
Yeah, I could see that. I could definitely see that there's the assumption that therefore you can't be in line with what the church teaches because you probably would be with a particular political party, which I think, you know, misunderstands people's, you know, allegiance to Jesus Christ supersedes allegiance or party. So they still have the duty to and responsibility to be a shepherd of souls and preach the authentic truth, you know, regardless of whether they think it's going to make the people in the church uncomfortable. They're here to get us to heaven, not to be our, you know, not to be tickling our ears with what they think we might want to hear.
Right, right. Gloria Purvis is our guest, EWTN superstar, host of one of the hosts of Morning Glory, and also one of the hosts of Authentically Free at Last. I think it's the 13 episodes or something. You can get it at EWTN.com or at the EWTN shop there. It's available to you. We have to take a quick break. We'll be back with more Being Black and Catholic in America with Gloria Purvis right after this on Catholic Answers Live.
This is Harry Connick Jr., and you're listening to Catholic Answers Live.
Hi, this is Tim Staples, and I'm challenging you to take the 20 Answers Challenge. Here's how the challenge works. When you purchase the sampler of all 26 books in the 20 Answers series, we're going to knock 60% off the price, and we're challenging you to finish them all this Lent and Easter season. And this year, to make it easier, we're offering free shipping on the sampler if you live in the continental United States. That's 60% off free shipping and over 500 answers to questions you have about the Catholic faith. Join us this Lent and Easter to take the 20 Answers Challenge, and together we can be part of something great. Call 1-888-291-8000 or visit the shop at Catholic.com now to get your set and begin taking the 20 Answers Challenge today.
We struggle with sin. We're distracted in prayer. We find it hard to be loving and easy to be selfish. Thankfully, the Church has given us Lent, the perfect time for reform, of reconversion to God and His will for us. The saints of the Counter-Reformation faced greater obstacles than these, yet they each found the grace to persevere during a tumultuous time in the Church. How can we do the same? Reform yourself is a good place to start. We all need to reform our souls. This Lent, let the saints who reformed the church show you how. Order your copy of Reform Yourself today by calling 1-888-291-8000, visiting the shop at Catholic.com, or asking for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
Homeschool Connections, an online provider of courses for your Catholic homeschool, is a sponsor of Catholic Answers Live. Homeschool Connections' website is homeschoolconnections.com.
Call now with your question, 888-318-7884. This is Catholic Answers Live.
Welcome back to our Super Big Giant Friday show here on Catholic Answers Live. I am Cy Kellett, your host. Our guest is Gloria Purvis, one of the hosts of EWTN's Morning Glory radio show. Gloria, thanks so much for being with us.
Mm-hmm.
We're discussing being Black and Catholic in America. I suppose, okay, so you go through this conversion, you become Catholic, and you kind of... It's fascinating to me that you learned the devotions from your Baptist grandmother.
Yes.
But did the Catholic Church, I mean, you came in as a very young, how old were you? 12 or 13?
I was 12. Yeah, I was 12 years old. Yeah, I was young.
So did anything surprise you about coming to the Catholic Church? I mean, was it very, very different from what you had experienced or basically... Oh.
Well, I had there was in Charleston, and still is there, St. Patrick's Catholic Church, which is predominantly African-American. So that was the parish I went to. And my neighbors across the street went to the church. I had a cousin that went there. And then my grandmother's Baptist church was a half block from there. So from going from being a United Methodist to being a Catholic, we had the same kind of worship style in the sense of...
Oh, yeah.
Organ, choir, you know, things like that. And except what I noticed about at least what struck me a lot more about Catholicism was the orderliness. We had some of that in the Methodist Church, like you followed certain things within the church, you know, you'd speak here and the pastor would speak here, you know, things like that. But I felt just this, the way the unity of response from the congregation was very moving to me, but it still had that kind of, I guess people would say, sort of quietness to it. Although I've been to other churches where there's a large Black population and it's full body worship, you know, tambourines, clapping. If the preacher says something moving, people will feel free to say amen, hallelujah, or say it again, Father, you know, stuff like that. So yeah, it was a similar experience in terms of worship style going from the Methodist Church in Charleston to the Catholic Church in Charleston. But I'd been to other Black Catholic churches that had a much more full body kind of a charismatic worship style, if you will.
And are there organizations, you know, for say Black Catholics in America that are, you know, kind of big organizations that might bring people together? Or
I will tell you this, I had never heard of the Knights of Columbus, until I was an adult, and I think, and I moved to the D.C. area. I was introduced to the Knights of Peter Claver, which was big in my parish, and they had the Ladies Auxiliary, and they also had the Junior Knights and Junior Daughters of St. Peter Claver. So that's what I was exposed to, and then later on I learned about the National Black Catholic Congress. I actually volunteer with them, and I've spoken at a lot of their congresses that they've had, so I'm familiar with them. And then, of course, I then became familiar with the Josephites, who were basically started to minister to Black Catholics. I think they started with the Mill Hill Fathers. And one of my priests who I love dearly, may his soul rest in peace, is Father Egbert J. Figaro. He was a Divine Word priest. And so, I just had exposure to those groups, you know, the Knights of Peter Claver, Junior Daughters, at my parish, Society of the Divine Word through Father Figaro, and then later on National Black Catholic Congress and the Josephites, just to name a few.
So a little bit more, if you wouldn't mind, about the National Black Catholic Congress. That's what is that, an actual congress that meets?
It is. They meet every 5 years roughly. The National Black Catholic Congress was founded, I think, in the 1800s. I don't have all my facts on me right now, by a gentleman named Daniel Rudd. And the reason he founded the Congress was to basically help to catechize the African-American population, because the church wasn't. That population was very much ignored. But he believed that, hey, this is real, this is the truth, so we have a responsibility to catechize and evangelize our own. And Daniel Rudd was really big about that. And the National Black Catholic Congress was started by him. It then took a little break and then was restarted again.
Let me put it this way. In the Protestant churches in the United States, there's often been a segregation between Black people and white people, because you'll have in the same town a Black Baptist church and a white Baptist church. And in the Catholic Church, we can't really do that.
Right.
Because you got to have there is a tradition, and maybe, you know, you had the Italian Catholics had their own parish, and the Polish Catholics and all that. But generally speaking, we're all in the same church together. But is there, to your knowledge, or in what you know about the history of Black Catholics in America, has there been institutionalized racism or institutionalized kind of segregation that's not you can only go to the Black Baptist church, you can't go to the white Baptist church, but more like you can't sit in this part of the church?
That's like Blacks were told to sit in the back of the church and they'd have smaller pews. I mean, some of the churches here still put a plaque up. I know when I went to Immaculate Conception Church in Washington, D.C., they had a plaque up sort of memorializing what happened, with those things in the church. I don't think that was specifically during Jim Crow per se, but yeah, it was Blacks were told to sit in the back of the church. They were denied becoming priests. I think Augustus Tolton had to leave the United States and go get educated in Rome and then come back to Chicago, and then still, you know, face a lot of opposition. Some other priests telling white parishioners that you go to mass by that Black priest and it's not a valid mass. You still have to go to mass. There's a good book about it called Desegregating the Altar, in terms of some of the challenges that were faced by Black men who were trying to basically enter the priesthood. But yeah, there's a history that I guess a lot of people aren't really aware of. I mean, even in my diocese, the first Bishop of Charleston, Bishop John England, wrote a sort of apologetics for slavery, if you will, to the then Secretary of State. This was well past the time that, of course, the church had made it clear that slavery was, you know, immoral. So there's a bit of a history here that people should maybe look into. So yeah, I was calling Desegregating the Altar, the Josephites and the Struggle for Black Priests, 1871 to 1960 by Stephen J. Ochs, O-C-H-S. It's a pretty good book to read if people are interested in that.
Well, thank you very much. Again, our number 888-318-7884. If you prefer the spelling version, it's 888-31-TRUTH. Gloria, we have a ton of people on the phone. How about we take some calls?
Yeah, that's great.
All
let's
right,
do that.
Let's start with Michelle in North Carolina. Michelle, you are on with Gloria Purvis. Your question, please.
Yes, hi. So I was just wondering, I know I heard your story, which is awesome. I grew up in the church. My mother was actually the convert. But what I have found is that when I meet people and they realize that I'm Catholic, they're always like, well, why did you not choose to go with your grandmother's faith, and why did your mom convert? Have you had your friends kind of question your faith as you became an adult as to why you stayed with your church?
I haven't had people necessarily ask why I stayed with the faith. I just had people make statements that the Catholic Church is racist, homophobic, and sexist. And then when I'm like, hey, I'm Catholic, they're like, what? You seem so normal and likable. I was like, imagine that. And so it gives an opportunity also then to have the conversation. Like, well, why do you think that the church is sexist? Like, what is it that you think about that? And what I find is it's often just a misunderstanding of what we believe. And so we'll have that conversation. And I'm like, I find that the church is actually the most revolutionary in terms of recognizing the dignity of women. They don't ask us to check our fertility at the door to become full members, like you might see in corporate America. You want to rise to the top? You know, you better not get pregnant when we find it inconvenient. You know what I mean? It doesn't ask any of those things of us as women. It just says, come, woman, as you are. You are made in the image and likeness of God, and you have your dignity from there. And so, you know, I think oftentimes it's just having the conversation. I often ask people when they say things, I ask them their understanding of the church, and I find 9 times out of 10, they don't know what they're saying. You know, they just don't know anything about the Catholic Church. They're getting their catechism from MSNBC or Rachel Maddow. And I'm like, why don't you read the catechism if you actually want to know what the church believes? So,
what do you think, Michelle?
I appreciate it. I you know, value, you know, what she's saying. I know, like, with my situation, like I said, they have questioned, like, well, why in the world did you? Because they don't understand, and they are a Baptist, and they come from a different point of view. Mm-hmm. And I went to a Baptist school because at my Catholic school, it went up to a certain grade. And so beyond that, my parents were like, you're going to stay in a Christian school, because our school didn't have that grade, because they only went to the sixth grade, and the year after when they added stuff. So I was the only Black Catholic in a Baptist school from grades 7 through 12, and I had to endure listening to them, you know, bash Catholics and all of Mary Oliver's and all that stuff.
Oh, yeah. I had that experience actually at work when I was working, and I came in with ashes on my forehead. And I've had that at other places, other jobs I've had, where people will come up and talk to me about, oh, you guys are idolaters and this and the other. And I'm like, well, why do you say that? And they're like, you got pictures of all these saints everywhere and you worship them. And I was like, no, we don't worship them. They're our friends and family. And I would go over to their desk and they'd have pictures of their family all over. And I said, oh, you're an idolater. And it's like, what are you talking about? I was like, you got pictures of all these people over here on your desk. You pray to them? And they're looking at me like, what do you mean? I said, just like you have pictures of your family, pictures of saints are our family in heaven. You know, they're part of the church triumphant, and I consider them family. And so when I have pictures up of these beloved people to me in my faith, it's pictures of my family, just like you have pictures of your family on your desk. And that sometimes they get it. It makes them it sort of moves around the furniture in their head when you can help them connect to practices that they're doing. You know, it's just like what I'm doing, but I'm doing it as a Catholic, but it's the same thing. But I'm not, you know, worshiping them. I'm honoring these members of my family who I love. And that sometimes that helps people get things.
Michelle, thank you very, very much for that call. You know, speaking of the saints, are there, you mentioned Peter Claver, of course, mm-hmm. but there are several American or African-American people who are moving towards sainthood.
Yes.
Want to mention a couple of them before we have
to
go to break?
Yeah, so we've got Julia Greeley coming up. You want me to do it now?
Yeah, go ahead. We have about a half a minute, so we'll,
okay. Julia Greeley, she's out of the Denver, Colorado. You've got Henriette DeLille. You've got Augustus Tolton. We've got Mother Lang, and we've got Pierre Toussaint, kind of all going on the path to sainthood.
Thanks. Maybe we'll talk about some of those individually if we have mm-hmm. a chance when we come back. Gloria Purvis is our guest. Gloria is one of the hosts of Morning Glory on EWTN Radio. And one of the hosts of Authentically Free at Last, a DVD set from EWTN that you can get at the EWTN shop. Give us a call, 888-318-7884. We'll be right back after this on Catholic Answers.
Do you subscribe to Catholic Answers magazine? We hope, but if not, right now we've got a deal that you're going to love. We've reduced the price and thrown in a free digital subscription when you subscribe. That's right, subscriptions to Catholic Answers magazine just got cheaper, $10 less on one-year subscriptions and $20 less on two-year subscriptions. And right now, when you purchase a subscription, you get a subscription to the digital edition added to your order for free. With a deal like that, it's the perfect gift for friends, family members, seminarians, your priest, even yourself. When you get right down to it, what other gift has the potential to touch hearts and reap eternal rewards? Log on today to CatholicAnswersMagazine.com and sign up yourself, your friends, and your family for a magazine that is bound to make a difference in their lives and the lives of those they meet. Share the faith. Defend the faith. Catholic Answers Magazine from Catholic Answers, the most trusted name in Catholic apologetics.
Who and what were the major figures and ideas of the Protestant Reformation? Is it true that the medieval Catholic Church was so corrupt that a total religious revolution was necessary? How did the Church respond to the Reformation, and what were its lasting effects on Christianity and world history? In 20 Answers, the Reformation, you'll find smart, solid answers to these questions and many more in a perfect introduction to the major players, concepts, and events of this defining period in Western history. 20 Answers, the Reformation is part of the 20 Answers series from Catholic Answers, offering hard facts, powerful arguments, and clear explanations of the most important topics facing the Church and the world, all in a compact, easy-to-read package. Visit shop.catholic.com today and take a look at this exciting series from Catholic Answers Press.
We need Catholic radio because we need the voice of the Church in the public forum. We live in a time that the secular voice dominates so thoroughly that we need to get that Catholic perspective out. Just as Fulton Sheen used radio and TV in the last century, we need to continue to use. This means to announce the Catholic faith in the public forum.
Bishop Robert Barron thinks Catholic radio is important. So should you.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. Don't want you to forget that our 20 Answers sampler, all 26 books in the 20 Answers series, we're offering for 60% off right now. 60% off. You buy the whole set of 26 for 40% of the usual price, and we ship the whole thing to you for free. And the challenge is, can you read them all by the end of the Easter season? We're just beginning Lent, so that gives you a lot of time to do it. Lots of folks are taking up the challenge. More than 700 already have. We'd love to send them to you. It's just 40% of their price and free shipping to your home, and they are on every kind of topic that you can probably imagine having to do with our faith, whether you want to know about Mary or the saints or miracles or the occult or any of that. Those 20 Answers books will do it for you. Just go to shop.catholic.com and get them now. shop.catholic.com. Again, we are talking with Gloria Purvis, host, one of the hosts of
Morning Glory in the on the EWTN radio network morning show. It should be called Morning Gloria, don't you think? Do you ever say that?
Yeah, well, the subtitles, they'll say Morning Gloria, but I have a little section of the show where I give a musing every day, like just my thoughts on something, and they call it Morning Gloria Musings.
Yeah, that's the way to do that. Okay.
Yeah.
All right, and you're also very active on Twitter. Mm-hmm. It's at Gloria_Purvis. Is that correct?
That's right. P-U-R-V-I-S.
Yep. All right. Mm-hmm. And I actually took a gander at your Twitter feed today, and apparently you've been to the movies lately.
Yes, I have. I had a great time. I went to see Black Panther, which was a visual feast for the eyes. It was very interesting. Lots of themes about love, loss, loyalty, you know, what's the moral thing to do, and a really strong push for the importance of fathers. It's the relationships of fathers with their sons figures greatly throughout the movie. Yeah,
and it's just getting killer reviews. I mean, extraordinary reviews, this movie.
Well, I think it's because it's such a well-told story, and it's attractive to watch. I mean, your eyes just, you know, you love it. And then there are these twists and turns and unsuspecting things happening in the movie. You're like, what's going to happen next? Oh, no. And but also what I like about it is there's no foul language. There's no nudity. Somebody makes a gesture to somebody that's, you know, not the best. But there's no nudity. There's no foul language. There's no inappropriate sexual content. It's something that you can take the family to see. The only reason I hesitate about taking my seven-year-old is because some of the scenes of loss, if she's attached to the character, she might feel a particular way.
Oh.
So that might be sort of, she might be like, you know, that would be the only reason I'm thinking of not taking her. But if she weren't sensitive in that regard, I would totally take her to see it, and I tell her to look down at one scene that I know is about to happen. I tell her to look down, but other than that, you know,
mom sees it first and then
just... Yes, that's exactly right. I have to screen these things. I can't, you know.
Well, I don't want to shock you, Gloria, and this may shock you what I'm about to say, but American media has not always made a positive portrayal of Black people. I don't know if
yeah. Could you imagine that? I think you're absolutely right. That's one of the unfortunately, a lot of the stereotypes. You don't see people that have agency. You don't see people who aren't living these pathological lives, you know, like it's drugs, pimps, prostitution, all this brokenness. And I will, even in my personal life, I would say that's not been my experience. So a lot of what I've seen on television in terms of portraying Black life, I'm like, wow, that is totally not my experience at all. But seeing Black Panther, I could totally relate to these characters that were about excellence, family, loyalty. I was like, no, that's more like how I grew up in terms of seeing that kind of togetherness. So you're absolutely right. And I think that's also why the movie has become is such a force, is that it's not how people are typically portrayed on the screen. And so, yeah, it's positive all the way around. It's a positive movie all the way around, in my opinion.
Well, you know, I think it's important for, you know, say, Black children, Black families and all to see that. But it's please don't take offense if you find this offensive. But I think it's actually more important for white children and white families because there's a lot of people in America who may live in, let's just put it this way. Most of their experiences of Black people are media experiences. They're not actual personal face-to-face experiences. And if all you know about Black people is what you see on TV, you're going to be scared of Black people. Like, you're going to be like, I don't know who these people are. But,
this is true.
You know? And so it's important that the cultural images are positive like that. So people who are intelligent, as you said, people of agency. Mm-hmm. I'm excited to see the movie. But the truth is I'm excited to see it because I'm always excited to see superhero movies.
Then you're going to love it because the superheroes, things they have going are phenomenal. Phenomenal. And you're going to like the Dora Milaje. Those are the women who guard the king.
Okay.
You're going to love them. That was really something too. It was just all around well-written, well-directed, well-acted. And I was reading an article, an interview with one of the actresses, the minor actresses on the on the set, she said it was like going to church because, you know, during breaks, everybody was talking about the miracles of God in their life and how they got to be where they are. So she was like, it was like going to church she was going to set for filming Black Panther.
Gloria Purvis is our guest. You can find out all about Gloria by going to @Gloria_Purvis, P-U-R-V-I-S, on Twitter. She maintains one of the best Twitter feeds you're going to find. We go now to Emily in Greenville, South Carolina, listening on AM 1300. Emily, thank you for being on with us. You are on with Gloria Purvis. Your question, please.
I almost said good morning, Gloria. I'm sorry. Anyway, yes, I want to just make a couple comments. I didn't hear the beginning of the show, so I'm not sure how you got interested in Catholicism. But I also, as a child, had friends that were Catholic, and they were very I was an impression, you know. Small children get to be, get impression. And I liked what they did, especially my one friend that always put all this holy water around her bed to keep monsters away. And angels and things.
All right.
Yes. And so when I got to be a teenager, I decided this is what I wanted to do. And so when I came home one day from school, my clothes were all packed on the porch. And my father said, if you want to be a Catholic, go down there to the convent. Well, of course, I couldn't go do that. But eventually, I became a Catholic, thanks be to God. And when I was growing up, I noticed that was the church that there were Black people going to. They were in our neighborhood. And they went to this little Catholic church over there. And everybody that was Catholic went there, including the Black friends I had that were Catholic. And they were very well accepted. And I thought, this was wonderful. Well, when I became, I was raised a Lutheran, and I was, like I said, a teenager. And a Black family wanted to join our parish, our church. And the people in the church thought they were, you know, high and mighty, and they weren't that wealthy anyway, but they were the people that led everything. We're going to leave the church. They were going to leave the church. I couldn't believe it.
They were going to leave the church. Why?
I can't believe it now, you know, that they did that.
Emily, why were they going to leave the church?
Because a Black family wanted to join our church, the Lutheran church.
Oh.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it's scary when you think about it, you know.
And was that a I'm just a little confused, Emily. Was that the Catholic? That was the Catholic church in your neighborhood? The Catholic
Lutheran church.
Oh, I see.
Lutheran church downtown. It was attended by people from every neighborhood, rich neighborhoods, poor neighborhoods, whatever. And the Catholic church was up in our poor neighborhood, and that's where a lot of my friends went. And
well, I'm
the
glad.
Catholic, the Black children there that were Catholic went there, too.
I'm glad we could pick on the Lutherans. That's important. That we.
Well, you know, but, I mean.
Go ahead, Gloria.
I guess what I was thinking is that, you know, it is a sad statement. It's a sad truth that, you know, that you could find that probably anywhere, right? And in any church. It's just the nature of the sin of racism, right? It's just the nature of sin that some people will not are not willing to accept, you know, their brothers and sisters in Christ of a different skin color. But let's pray for them. You know what I mean? We should pray for those people, because I'm surely hoping that when they see heaven and see that it's a multitude of races, that they don't reject heaven. You know what I mean? So let's pray for them. I mean, it's just another example of the brokenness of humanity, that we're fractured by sin. So we need to pray for those people.
Okay, Emily?
Can I still speak with you? In my church now, we have people that come in their dress from their African countries.
Mm-hmm.
It's fantastic to see.
Yeah, it is
and
beautiful.
And they sit anywhere they doggone well please.
Well.
Any plaques up. We have nothing to segregate anybody from anything. And we've had Black priests come through. We've had, right now we have two priests, one's from Colombia, one's from Philippines. So we're blessed to have people from different countries. It's just wonderful to see. I think it's how it's going to look when we all get to heaven.
Amen, Emily. Thank you. I have to say, Gloria, as a Catholic, when I was in college in the 80s, there was this new term, multiculturalism, and they started talking about multiculturalism, and it just didn't impress me because I had grown up in a Southern California Catholic church, and everybody was there. I mean, Southern California Catholics are from the Philippines, from Vietnam, from Mexico, from the United States. And I happened to live next to a Marine Corps base, so they were from all over the country. I mean, one of the beautiful things about the Catholic Church, when it's properly lived,
Right.
Is that it's everybody.
That it is. I mean, Catholic means universal, right? And we know the church is a church for sinners to come and encounter Christ and be converted. And it wasn't that the Lord said only this person or that person, but he wants all nations, right? For me, my experience was I was in a church that was predominantly African-American. Even the priest at the time when I was coming up was African-American. And then when he passed on, they had non-African-American priests at the parish. But nonetheless, you know, when we face the brokenness of humanity, I think our answer isn't to then blame the faith, because really it's people not living the faith is when we have all these problems. It's just the brokenness of the human person, and we should pray for them and continue to do what we need to do. And I would say, maybe if there are people who are listening and says, gosh, am I that cold person that's unwelcoming or whatever, just think, if it's somebody, if you treat everybody like they're a family member you haven't met, I think you'll be doing well. And remember, we're going to spend eternity together in heaven, so why don't we get to know each other now?
All right, Gloria, can you be the head of the hospitality committee at my parish? Because I don't think that message is getting through to everyone.
Right. Well, I'm an extrovert, as you can tell, right?
Gloria Purvis is our guest, one of the hosts of Morning Glory on EWTN Radio. We're going to take a quick break. We'll be right back with more. And when we come back, we're going to talk a little bit about being a pro-life woman well. And how that figures into the whole story. I want to find out about how you became so powerfully a voice for the unborn, for the vulnerable, to us Catholics, to everybody, when we come back. We'll be right back with Gloria Purvis after this on Catholic Answers Live.
Stay with us for more Catholic Answers Live.
Hi, this is Trent Horn, and I'm challenging you to take the 20 Answers Challenge. Here's how the challenge works. When you purchase the sampler of all 26 books in the 20 Answers series, we're going to knock 60% off the price, and we're challenging you to finish them all this Lent and Easter season. And this year, to make it easier, we're offering free shipping on the sampler if you live in the continental United States. That's 60% off, free shipping, and over 500 answers to questions you have about the Catholic faith. Join us this Lent and Easter to take the 20 Answers Challenge, and together, we can be part of something great. Call 1-888-291-8000 or visit the shop at Catholic.com now to get your set and begin taking the 20 Answers Challenge today.
Whatever I have learned, writes Catholic Answers founder Carl Keating, I have learned from the masters of the craft. In his new book, Booked for Life, a bibliographic memoir of an accidental apologist, Carl gives future generations a roadmap of what it takes and what it means to become a Catholic apologist. In the way only Carl can, he recounts numerous real-life situations he has encountered in his long career that illustrate the apologetic lessons he's learned. Then, drawing on a lifetime of experience, Carl reveals the books that helped him learn to defend the Catholic faith. Order your copy of Booked for Life today by calling 1-888-291-8000, logging on to the shop at Catholic.com, or asking for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
Pope Francis reminds us that it does not take a specialized degree in theology to become a great evangelist. We're all called to evangelize. Think about the woman at the well. After she encountered Jesus, she immediately went into the city and invited others to meet him as she had. You and I can go out now and do the same. And St. Paul Street Evangelization can help. Get involved today by contacting us at streetevangelization.com. That's streetevangelization.com.
Call now with your question, 888-318-7884. This is Catholic Answers Live.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live, great big huge giant Friday show. We've got Gloria Purvis with us this hour. Gloria, one of the hosts of Authentically Free at Last, a wonderful show, now a DVD set from EWTN, and you might want to get that. Who's in that with you? Deacon Burke Sivers is.
Yeah, good friends. I mean, God has blessed me with such good friends. Deacon Harold Burke Sivers and Damon Owens, who's known for Theology of the Body Institute. He's now Joy to Be, I think is what where he is now. Uh-huh. Very good friends. Actually, both met in real life. Damon and his wife and my husband and I met years ago, actually outside Howard University Divinity School, protesting their religious coalition for reproductive choice meeting.
What? And so
that's how we met and became friends. And then years ago, Deacon Harold heard me speaking actually at a regional Black Catholic Congress, and I was talking about, you know, the pro-life movement in the Black community. And he came up to me afterwards, and he was like, oh my gosh, we just got to be friends. And we became friends since that day till now.
You know, that brings me to, I will get the call, so if you're on the phone, don't worry, I'm going to get to you. But I'm you have well, first of all, your conversion story is, it's a little bit St. Paul. It's really, really impressive, you know. But you have a second conversion story where you were convicted that you needed to be fully, actively engaged as a pro-life woman.
Oh, yeah. See, you know, I was a good Catholic. You know, I went to Mass. I believe what the church taught. I was pro-life. One day at Mass, we were saying the creed. When you get to the, you know, part where you say, I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, and giver of life, I had what I could only describe as a very teeny tiny mini chastisement, because at that moment, I had this interior sort of, am I telling the truth? Am I lying? Am I blaspheming the Lord? How can I say I believe in the Holy Spirit as the Lord and giver of life when I'm doing nothing to protect that innocent gift of life as it's being destroyed here on earth? And I fell to my knees and I thought, Lord, how can I ask you for the gift of eternal life when I'm doing nothing to protect the life you're giving here on earth? And it was really like it all happened in a split second. And so I had this like insatiable hunger to know what the church taught and why. And when you have that moment, trust me, when you ever have that moment, even if it's a really small one, I still remember it like it was yesterday. That the Lord letting me know, you know, I better get to it. That I was not, even though I believed and I was this and that, it was, you know, what good was what I was believing when I wasn't really, you know, I didn't do anything. I was not, there was nothing to demonstrate what, you know,
what your belief
that
was.
I believed. Yeah, exactly. So.
Yeah. And how's that experience been for you?
I would say this. It was like the moment you say yes, the Lord makes all these things happen for you. Mm-hmm. So I would say I did a lot of witnessing on my job about abortion and churches, teaching on sexuality, understanding a human person, just from people saying things to me. And I would say things back, and then we would have these conversations. And I'd be thinking, I am going to get so fired. You know, and I'd be saying that to the Lord. I was like, well, you know, all money is yours, Lord. You put these people in my face, so I'm just going to have the conversation. And then I was would start a ministry at my parish with my husband. We started the Gabriel Project, which helped women in need. We would have discussions with the young adult groups. We would invite other young adult groups from other parishes to come with us, to come to our church, and let's have these open discussions. I ended up teaching NFP with my husband, doing pre-Cana ministry, giving talks about marriage ministry. I mean, just you name it. When you say yes, the Lord will make opportunities for you in any place you're willing to go.
Yeah, right. But you're right, indeed. You got to be willing to go. and so you're involved in Black Catholics United for Life? Is that right?
Yeah, I actually started that a long time ago with some friends, and we were, working with the Josephites. We worked with, at the time, the head of the pro-life office for the Archdiocese of Washington, and we went around the country in Black parishes and would have a weekend of pro-life talks, you know, like a conference, if you will, and we would have open mic where people can get up and ask their questions, their challenges, you know, and trying to understand or live the faith. And it was like just a marvelous time. I remember a woman who was an OBGYN having a straight on open conversion right there. She was standing up, because I remember her starting to stand up and pull her hair, because she was having like a moment of, oh my God, what have I been doing? And we asked her what was going on, and she was just like, this is the first time I've ever heard this. And thanks be to God, we had people in the audience to hook up with her, to help her get plugged in with people who could help her, who were also pro-life doctors and were in the pro-life movement, that could help shepherd her as she had this very immediate conversion right then and there.
Wow, what an extraordinary story. I'm realizing as you're speaking too, maybe you don't listen to God very well, and that's why he's got to do these shocking things to you, Gloria. Maybe he's...
You know, I think you're right. I think he's like, this chick ain't. I think so. I think he's like, Lord, let me help, you know, let's help this poor child because she just ain't getting it.
Like,
she's
he has to light you on fire, literally, to get your attention.
Yeah. He's like, she's got a thick head. Let me knock through there. And so, yeah, I would say it's not from any specialness. I think it's just quite the opposite. It's actually, it's somebody special out there with all these gifts that ain't saying yes, so he's got to come to the rocks like me and make the rocks sing out.
Well, I don't know if that's entirely correct, that analysis. Yeah, I think you might have your gifts.
I don't know.
Let's go to the phones. Jolena in Lebanon, Texas is listening on the EWTN app. Jolena, you are on with Gloria Purvis.
Actually, it's not Texas, it's Tennessee, but that's okay. I love Texas just the same. But, Gloria, I just wanted to tell you, I was just sitting here listening to your story. And first of all, I just want to tell you how much I admire you for, you know, your family was the faith that they were, and you decided to answer God's call and become Catholic at such a young age. And I really appreciate that. That took a lot of courage, you know, and I just wanted to tell you how much that I appreciate that.
Oh, well, thank you. You know, I don't feel particularly courageous. I have to tell you.
I mean, you know, your family, you know, at the time, of course, now I'm sure they're all Catholic, but, you know, before, yeah, I think, didn't you say one of them was Baptist and one of them was
Methodist.
Methodist, that's right. Mm-hmm. And so now, and then you're going, you and your sisters are going to a Catholic school, mm-hmm. and then, you know, you hear God calling you, you know, as you just, you know, I was talking about a minute ago your conversion story, and then, you know, you just said, I'm going to do it, and, you know, because, you know, you didn't know how your family was going to react.
Jolena, can I just interrupt you and ask you, are you thinking about becoming Catholic, Jolena?
Actually, I'm considering it, but I've got some obligations, and I'm talking to God about them, and, but yes, I'm very much considering.
Well, look, you could take that step. I'll tell you what, you just ask him, and he's going to make a way for you. You tell him about those obligations, and he'll make a way for you. And thank you for, you know, if it's inspiring anybody in any way, thanks be to God. That's all on him. I will just tell you, I didn't know that it would, at 12, I didn't know that it could be a problem. You know what I mean? I didn't know what, as an adult, probably would know or think about. I just knew that's what I was going to do. And I don't... It's hard to say what would have happened if they had, you know, absolutely prohibited me. But I was I will say they knew what kind of child I was, though. They knew that I was somebody that didn't, you had to convince me. I wasn't somebody that would do things at the spur of the moment like that, not anything like that. And, you know, I had the opportunity to not do it, you know, but they dropped me off every Sunday for Mass. And I had to decide to go in there by myself, or I could have said, no, I'll stay in the car and go over with you guys to the Methodist Church. But it was, no, I go. I think about it now, and it's kind of nuts that at 12 that I went and did this and would sit in, you know, in the pew by myself if there was nobody there that I knew, you know, but I got to know most of the people. Like if I went to a Mass and my cousins weren't there or my neighbors weren't there, I would stay in Mass, you know, because it was my relationship with the Lord. I mean, I can't imagine not saying yes. I mean, it wasn't like I really had I didn't really feel like there was an option not to go. I was so convinced. I was so moved. I was changed, and I wanted that. So, but thank you. I'm glad it was inspiring to you in any way.
In the EWTN, I started listening. I think I had started listening to Call to Communion because I had some questions, and then actually one morning I started listening to you and to your coworkers, and y'all do such a great job, and I appreciate and love y'all so much for that.
Oh, Jolena, thank you. Thank you for listening. Thank you for that feedback. I'm going to be sure to share it with them on Monday because we get up bright and early, and I'm not a morning person. So I'll be sure to share that with them. Thank you for listening, and thank you for your kind words. And, Jolena, we're going to be praying a storm for you, okay?
Thank you. I appreciate that. God bless. Mm-hmm.
God bless you.
Thank you so much, Jolena. Thank you, Gloria Purvis, for just a wonderful hour.
Cy, I've enjoyed it so much. Thank you. I hope you guys might let me not be rude and invite myself, but I hope I can come back on sometime soon.
Oh, yeah. No, be rude. Yes, we want you. You can find all about, or you can find Gloria and her at her Twitter handle, @Gloria_Purvis. That's P-U-R-V-I-S. I recommend that you do. You can also get up really early if you're on the West Coast and find her on EWTN's Morning Glory radio program. Again, Gloria Purvis, just a great hour. Thanks for sharing it with us.
Thank you. God bless you.
And thank you to all of our listeners. Thanks for joining us this week, all week. We do appreciate it. And we're going to take a little break. But we'll be back here Monday, God willing. Jesus Christ is the light of the nations. And we'll see you next time on Catholic Answers Live.